Hey everybody, it's Peter from the Kia Hyundai channel. That's Kevin behind me. We'll introduce him a little later. Today we're talking about the 2022 Hyundai Tucson Preferred Package. Not the Preferred with Trend, which we've looked at before, but just the Preferred. And I really like this car. There's a lot that they do really, really, really well. So we're gonna go fully in depth. We spent about a half an hour reviewing these vehicles, and we're gonna go into those details that don't show up on other videos. So if you're ready with us and you're not live with us, if you wanna get right to the content, you can skip to that 3 minute mark. If you are live with us, you can hang out. We're gonna talk about some news and some notes, and I'll also show you how to join us live for those of you that still stuck around. So let's flip the camera around over here. Jeanette says, I'm ready. Ian says, hi everyone. Well, hello to you as well. All right, let me flip around here. I'm on the wrong page. There we go. If you want to join us, you just have to go to our, where are we? There we go, our YouTube page. If you go to our YouTube page, this is kind of what it looks like, but if you refresh it exactly at 2 o'clock, which is what we're doing right now, and many of our regulars will do as well, you will see the live video right there. I'm just gonna make sure my computer's muted. There we go. If you click on the live video, you're gonna be forced to watch an ad. Meanwhile, I'm gonna run a little ad myself. If you're looking to buy a car, Kia or Hyundai in Ontario, give me a call. As soon as this video is done, we'll give you contact information. You can reach out to me and I will connect you with our sales team for Hyundai or Kia. Anywhere in Ontario, we can help you out. So I'm just gonna skip the ad that's running for a competitive dealer that's not putting in the work, and we'll go back down here. All right, if you're here for the first time, make sure you just drop a comment, say hello, just say something nice, and we'll go from there. And if you want, it would be really great if you could leave a like right now. There's 23 of you on right now. If you all dropped a like right now, we're gonna have a whole bunch of people here, and that makes it for a more fun video. All right, what's going on in news and notes? First of all, let me just explain what's going on with Kevin over here. Kevin, if you remember, a year ago, hung out with me, because when we started these pre-COVID times, actually, this room was completely unfinished, and Kevin used to basically help build most of this room. We're now painting that wall black. Why? Because Kia's going black. We're gonna put some logos up there. We're gonna make it the Brantford Kia Studio. It's gonna be pretty cool when it's done. In the meantime, Kevin doesn't get to stop working just because I get to work. So we're gonna keep our distance from each other, but we are in the same room and we're gonna hang out together, and that's about it. So what else is going on? We have three Tellurides in stock. One of them is right over there. You can see it over there. There's a white one as well. Those are both Night Sky editions. We have an EX model. Tomorrow's a big day. We're gonna take a look at the Night Sky and the EX. In other words, two different trim lines of the Telluride together in the same video bay on the same day, so you can look at them side by side. And they are the 2022 models, which have new logos. I'm gonna go through them when I'm done this video and make sure there's no new technology in there. There is some new software, so we've seen that. So I'll make sure that I show you the things that other people don't even know about, things that aren't in the specs. If there's anything new, I'll find it and we'll show it to you. All right, we're 10 seconds away from joining. Obviously, nobody wants to give me a like until I earn it. I get that, and that's cool. We only got 9 likes, and I can deal with that. All right, 3 minutes in, let's flip around, and here we go. Okay, so 2022 Tucson. First thing I'm gonna do is show you the key. Let's just get that out of the way. On this preferred package, you do get the keyless entry. Obviously, this one's still wrapped up in the plastic, but that's a nice little feature to have the keyless entry, because when you have this, not only is that you can start the car without the key or without an actual key, you also have a little push button on the door so you can unlock the doors, unlock the trunk, you can get into it. Basically, you never need to pull that key fob out of your purse or out of your pocket, and you can just get right in the car. So nice feature there. This car's got it. You know, on the higher trims, it does have the Smart Park on the remote. This one doesn't have that. This is a trim that I highly, highly recommend. It's almost built perfectly for me. It's missing one feature out of all the things that I like in a vehicle, but it's pretty much perfect for what I like as far as a value model, but not quite all the luxuries that you don't need. So I do recommend you consider this package with the Trend package. If you are looking for the same engine, same idea, same look, but you'll have the full panoramic sunroof in there, you'll have a whole bunch of luxuries added there. It's only about a $2,000 option. So the only option this one has is the all-wheel drive. And then I can show you the MSRP for this car, which is right up over here. MSRP is what we always show on our videos to compare pricing, $30,299. So pretty good value. You can get this car in front-wheel drive as well. We chose an all-wheel drive because, like I said, that's kind of how I would equip it, and that's really how most of them are selling in our market. So out front, you've got a pretty familiar face now. You've seen this on pretty much every ad for this vehicle. They show this face. On the preferred package, your daytime running lights over here are not tinted, so they don't quite blend into the grill. We're gonna show you the video, or show you them on a little bit later in the video, but you can see there is a little bit of a difference on the higher trim levels where you end up with the tinting in there, which blends those lights right into the grill. This one, it doesn't have that, but when they're on, it looks perfect, and when you're driving, that's the way it is. I don't see the Tucson too much where I live. Yeah, it's very, very new. So keep in mind, in Tucson trims, when you move to the higher trims, you move to a hybrid. This is a 2.5 liter, 187 horsepower, 178 foot-pounds of torque, naturally aspirated engine. That means it does not have a turbo. It is not a hybrid, just a standard engine. And the one thing you're not gonna see me do in this video is drive it. But I can tell you that it drives very, very, very well. So it's very smooth, very comfortable. And yesterday we were looking at a couple of Kias. This one would slide in between something like the Seltos in the Kia lineup and the Sportage, or Seltos and the Sorento, which is really where the next Kia Sportage is gonna fit in. It's longer than our current Sportage, and it's longer than the previous Tucson, and it's kind of right-sized, if you ask me. It's still very compact and easy to drive, but it gives you a little bit more rear seat space, a little bit more trunk space, and we're gonna show you both of those features a little bit later in this video. All right, let's jump in. Somebody says memory seats. Well, not on this trim level. So this trim level, like I said, is a really good value package where you get a surprising amount of features that I think a lot of people will appreciate, but you're not overspending for features that maybe you don't want. Stepping in here, you can see they are cloth seats. They're height adjustable, so you can move up, down, in, out. You've got a good telescopic and tilt steering wheel, so you can have a lot of adjustment there. It really doesn't matter what size you are, you're probably gonna fit in this car without any trouble, and if you share the car, very easy to adjust everything out. All right, now we jump in here. Some of the higher trim levels, they have a fabric or a cloth kind of look over in this type of area. It kind of wraps its way around. This one doesn't have that. It has more of a rubbery type feel to a lot of the dash pieces. It is soft touch pretty much wherever you touch. And as you come in here, you can see Hyundai's steering wheel. Let's first just hit the start button right over here. If you're looking at the new Santa Cruz, that's Hyundai's new pickup truck, you're looking at the future right now, because this is very similar in design of the Santa Cruz. The Santa Cruz is built off of this platform, and you have a similar dash layout here. This one does not have the 10¼-inch screen like the higher trim levels have, and I don't think that's a problem. I said this is the highest trim? No, I didn't say this is the highest trim. This is one step up from the base model, one step up, so it goes essential and preferred. All right, the dash in here I quite like. Now, one thing that's gone on with the Hyundai recently is if you get the digital screen, the speedometer and the tachometer have sort of flipped sides from what they used to be in the past, and this is the first non-digital screen where they also have flipped that. So you can see left side you now have speedometer, right side you have tachometer, which is the opposite of the way we've done things for a while. For someone like me who's in a Hyundai and a Kia every single day, takes a little bit of adjustment, but very clean look here. I really like the way they've styled this out. Instead of the full circle, just the sort of side gauges, very easy to get used to, nice and clean look. And you have the temperature gauge, fuel gauge in there as well. And of course it centers around this digital display, which is a nice color display. Good features and options on here. Again, anytime a fuel efficiency number is shown on a dealership vehicle, just ignore it. It's probably not very accurate. It's usually much worse display than it is in real life. And of course, the speedometer in there. So you've got really nice coloring, really nice details. Couple of features I kind of was surprised to see at this trim level of car are these features. You have lane keeping assist, which is right over, I can't see the lane keeping assist, but lane follow assist is right in here. So lane follow assist is gonna turn on that ability to, let's just show you in the dash here, have the ability to keep itself centered in the lane and the ability to keep it centered, or ability to keep it marked in the lane. And this steering wheel, which I turn on and off from the steering wheel, it will go green when it sees lane markers and can keep you centered in the lane. So what that means is this car is capable of steering itself, which sounds kind of freaky and kind of maybe not like the thing you want until you get used to it. I always tell people, drive it for a week or so, and almost everybody comes back and says, yes, that's a feature I absolutely love. So what it does is it takes the stress out of driving by keeping you centered in the lane. And I said this a few times in another video last week. I recently went on vacation. I have two vehicles. One of them keeps centered in the lane, like this car. Another one does not have that feature. And the entire time I'm driving, I'm correcting myself, centering myself in the lane. And you start thinking about how often you do that. You get used to that if you've never had it. But once you have a car like this, you keep your hand on the wheel, the car keeps itself centered in the lane. And on a long trip, makes it so much easier to drive. And then the other benefit you have on this car, which is really something I didn't expect in a cloth car, no sunroof, some of these features you don't see very often, you do have your smart cruise control. So let's talk about that for a second. Smart cruise control, of course, will keep the distance from the vehicle in front of you. So if you're going, let's call it 100 kilometers an hour, someone comes out in front of you and they're going 90 kilometers an hour, your car will automatically slow down. And you can set the distance you want to keep from that vehicle. But the big benefit with smart cruise control, and this is where I use it more often than I ever would have expected, is I use it in traffic because it works right down to stop and go traffic. So when the car ahead of you accelerates to 28 kilometers an hour and down to 16 and up to 35 and down to 2 and down to 0 and back up to 10, this cruise control can control your acceleration and braking in those situations as well. And that's where smart cruise control is really, really helpful, I find. It takes all the stress out of stop and go driving. You combine that with the lane follow assist, and now you're not really spending a whole lot of time centering yourself in the lane, and you've got all these features. So he says, this would be good if you needed an alignment. Well, you can always check your alignment or see how it feels at the dealership, but you can always turn these systems off as well. If they're not something you want, you can turn it off. But it really takes the stress out of driving, and you do have those in this trim line. So both are controlled right here on the steering wheel. Really nice feature. Now, you step over to the stereo system, and again, in a cloth car, you tend to expect AM, FM with HD radio maybe would be the highest you could do. So we're going to click on here, and you can switch the band over here. AM and FM, of course. So when you have FM, let's turn the volume down for a second. You do have HD radio. So that's kind of to be expected. This is what you would want, AM, FM. But when you switch the band, you also have Sirius satellite radio. So kind of a different thing than you might think on this type of trim level. So smart cruise control, lane follow assist, HD radio, and satellite radio, which is a pretty good feature. The reason we have no signal is just because we're inside right now. And the other big thing, again, a real step up, especially compared to our competitors, Apple CarPlay and Android Auto is in this car, but it's not just the wired connection. You now have wireless Android Auto and wireless Apple CarPlay. And if you think about how you use wireless CarPlay and Android Auto, even with the wire, you're using that primarily as your navigation. You can do your voice texting, you can do your phone calls, you can stream your music and do all those things. You can control a number of different apps, but most of us use it for navigation. And now that it's wireless, you could be out running around town, oh, you have to pick up the kids, or oh, you have to go on this and that. If you're like me, you buy stuff online from other people used because that can be fun. And all of a sudden you get a call from your wife, you answer the call, and she says, oh, I need you to go to number 3 Market Street. Okay, well then you just put in the Market Street through Siri or through the Google phone. You can call it up here wirelessly and it drops in. And the only feature missing from this car, in my opinion, that would make it perfect for me is a wireless phone charger. This car does not have the wireless phone charger, which isn't a huge deal the way my phone lasts. It's not a big deal. You can always plug it into the USB port there, the USB port there. There's a 12-volt socket in the center as well. It's just that would have made it perfect for me. So Hyundai, if you're listening, that's what would have made this car absolutely perfect for me, especially when you have the wireless CarPlay, the ability to just set your phone down, have it charge. Of course, you can get that in the higher trim levels of this car. Down here, you'll see some higher trim levels. They have the push-button gear shift. This one has the regular, traditional automatic transmission. I will say that this little sticker right here might skew your view of it, so we're going to rip that right off. That's just shipping plastic down there. Once you have it in drive, let's put it in drive, you can tilt it this way and shift your own gears. It is an 8-speed transmission. Now, some of our 8-speed transmissions are dual-clutch transmissions. This is just a regular automatic transmission. So if you think back to the previous Tucson, it was a 6-speed in the past. Now you've got 8 gears. That does a couple things for you. It's really good for fuel efficiency. It's also really good for just overall drivability and keeping you in the right power band. You can tow 2,000 pounds with this car. So if you have a lightweight utility trailer or a regular utility trailer, or a lightweight camping trailer, you can do that as well. Coming around, let's keep looking down here. Flip the camera. Come on, camera. There we go. Flip it around. There we go. You've got a couple nice features here. So you've got the electronic parking brake. Your drive mode buttons are here. So if we switch through our drive modes, we're going to come back to the dash. It'll be Eco, Normal, Sport, and Smart. We'll talk about those in a second. Hill descent control, because you do have an all-wheel drive, you get some of those all-wheel drive type functions. Automatic start stop. So when the car comes to a stoplight, it is capable of turning itself off. That saves you some fuel. It is instant in its turning back on. So it's a feature that a lot of people don't like from other manufacturers. I quite like it on this car. It does save you fuel, and it's instant, which is really important there. And auto hold is my favorite feature. So auto hold is really great for red lights or especially drive-throughs. With the electronic parking brake, you can set the auto hold up. So when you release the brake pedal, instead of creeping forward, the car stays in place. Now, anytime you release the brake pedal, your brake lights will turn off. But a lot of people like that. If they go through the drive-thru, if their foot slips off the brake, you're not going anywhere. So they use that quite a bit. And this just pulls up your backup camera, which let's just take a look at that. It is crystal clear. When you're filming a screen, that's a terrible way to show a screen. It does not show the clarity, but you can really see it's a really wide angle screen and it's crystal clear. Now, this car has blind spot detection, which we all know that helps see things in your blind spot. Actually, I think it has blind spot collision avoidance as well. I'll have to double check that with the specs. But you also have the same hardware as the blind spot detection that can help see things that you can't see on this camera. And in some cases, you can't even see out the window. If there's a person crossing your path, you will have rear cross traffic alert, whether it's a person or a vehicle, things that aren't shown in your backup camera. And if you look at me here, let me just flip it around. When I look out the side here, if there's a van parked beside me, I can't possibly see what's beside me. Oh, that's really white balance issue. But I can't possibly see what's beside me if there's a van parked there. So your rear cross traffic alert can warn you of things that you can't possibly see. And it all uses the blind spot detection hardware. So I'm pretty good about seeing things in my blind spot. Most blind spots you can adjust for, you can move your head, you can get your mirrors adjusted right, that they're not truly blind spots. But if you're parked beside something taller than you and you're backing out of a parking spot, it truly is a blind spot. You can't see through metal. And if you can, I'd like to know how you do that. So here, of course, you can be warned of things that are crossing your path that you can't possibly see. So really smart feature there that goes along with that blind spot detection, and that camera can turn off there. Keep scrolling down, come all the way back here. And this is gonna be hard to film just because the angle they're on, they have a little reflection with the camera. I don't have any issues seeing them in real life, but if I put my right hand down here, they very easily reach the heated seats, heated steering wheel, and heated seats on the passenger side as well. So three levels of rump roasters, as I like to call them, in the front seats, and you also have that heated steering wheel. So the heated steering wheel and the gear shift knob, both nicely leather wrapped, and it's quite nice. Let's take a look at that dash again, because we mentioned we come back to the drive modes. We'll take a look in here, and let's just throw the drive modes on. Where are we? There we go. Drive modes, Eco, let's go with Eco. Eco, Normal, Sport, and Smart. So you have a fourth drive mode. A lot of time when you have a Smart mode, they don't bring the Eco. Let's talk about that really quickly, why you have an Eco. The Eco mode, basically the dominant feature of it is it's going to resist downshifts. You're gonna give it a little bit of throttle and it's not gonna dump down a gear. Give it a little bit more throttle, it's not gonna jump down a gear. If you need it to really accelerate in Eco mode, you're gonna have to really get into throttle, and then it's gonna rev quite a bit, give you all the power you need, but it's gonna give you a good portion of throttle travel without forcing a downshift. So great if you drive efficiently anyways, it works really well with you. Some people don't love that feature. If you're getting out and you're trying to pass someone, you give it a little gas, give it a little gas, or you're getting on the highway and it's not downshifting, and then you give it a lot of gas and it downshifts. That's the one issue with the Eco mode. Works great for most people, but a couple situations it may not be perfect. So then what you do, if you are that kind of driver, you're gonna put it in the Smart mode. The Smart mode will keep you in that Eco mode unless you get into it on the throttle. If you get into on the throttle, it will move it to a normal mode or a sport mode if it has to, but it will always bring it back to an Eco mode on its own. So Smart mode is my favorite way to drive this car. That's what I recommend if you're test driving the car. Normal mode is exactly like the car would come from the factory. It's just sort of a normal car. And then the sport mode, of course, peps things up a little bit. Now, sport mode's good for a couple things. A lot of you driving an SUV like this probably aren't thinking, hey, I need something really sporty. But what if you're towing that utility trailer or that small camping trailer, you're heading up a hill? If you throw it in sport mode on that hill, it's gonna keep the revs up a little bit, it's gonna keep you in the power band, maybe make it a little bit easier for you to drive. So anytime you need to keep it in the revs, keep it in the power band, sport mode can do that for you. All right, we're at 43 likes. We got 23 likes. We got 44 people on right now. You had 50 earlier. Do me a favor, guys, hit the like button. We're gonna jump over, take your questions, and then we're gonna go rear seat space, trunk space, we're gonna look at the head lighting, and we're gonna answer all of your questions. So if you had a question, I saw a few of them coming in, we'll answer them. If you have one, you can feel free to ask it right now. And it looks like my begs for likes are just not working as well as they used to, so we'll have to work on that a little bit. All right, let me just jump over here. I'm gonna show you to the vehicle, and that's still zoomed in. Let's get that a little fixed. Oh boy, I'm having trouble here. There we go. You can see Kevin in the background there making our room change right in front of your eyes. And that's pretty cool. All right, so what do we got? Be good if, there we go. Wish modern cars came with old style radio tuner knobs. Yeah, that'd be cool. This one doesn't have that. So the thing with this car is you've got a lot of presets and you've also got steering wheel control. So it has a slider knob that you roll up and down. Works pretty well. But yeah, it's different than the tuning knob. But again, 99% of the driving I do in my car, I'm controlling the radio through its presets, and I'm controlling all of those through the steering wheel controls. So less of a concern to me than I think it used to be. What's your favorite part about the interior, says Connor? Oh, there's a lot of things. That's a good question. We'll get back to that one. So we'll ask that. We'll find that in a second. Do you have to turn the parking brake off before you drive away? So that's an interesting one, and it really depends on the car. Most of the Kias that I've driven with the parking brake will not turn the parking brake on automatically, and it will turn off automatically. So, you know, basically if you use it, then you're fine. So my Kia Soul EV, I can turn the parking brake on myself. When I put it in drive, it automatically turns off. On some of the Hyundai products, when I park on a hill, the electronic parking brake comes on automatically, but it does not turn off automatically. So there may be some settings that I have to dig through. The reason I haven't brought it up is frankly because I have to go through which cars do what. So I can't promise you that this one will turn off automatically. Some do, some don't. I have a feeling this one won't just because it hasn't got an electronic gear shift, and I think those are that's what's talking to everything. I'm not 100% positive, but it will give you any kind of warning if you try to drive away with it on. But this particular car, I'm not sure if the electronic parking brake will turn on automatically or turn off automatically. But that's a great question. I'll have to dig into that a little bit more. Isn't it so satisfying when you peel the plastic off a brand new car? Oh yeah, I'm peeling plastic off cars all the time. Okay, always wonder about the difference in Eco and Sport. Yeah, we talked about the drive modes a little bit. Can the guy painting the wall paint the car black? Yes, but it's going to cost me. Is there a sunglasses holder? That's a great question because we know in the world of Yuvo Intelligence on the Kia world and BlueLink in the Hyundai world, they sometimes are moving them away and there's not. There is no sunglasses holder. You do have the BlueLink system now. They've gotten rid of the one navigation button because you don't really need that anymore. You've got your phone to do that. Still a tow button, still an SOS, but what that really means, more importantly than that, than those buttons, most people use this as a cell phone app. So you can remote start the car from your cell phone. You can check if you've left the doors locked, if there's something left open, window or something like that, you can be notified. So pretty cool little app, and this car does come with it. And again, a bit of a surprise given the trim line. Usually we were seeing that kind of thing, the smart cruise control, those kind of things at a higher trim line. And I guess what we're getting at is maybe this is a higher trim car than we thought because it really has all those key functions that we thought. Is there a garage opener and preferred Trend? I'll have to double check the Trend package. There is no garage door opener in the preferred. So when you add that $2,000 Trend package, you do get quite a bit. We did do a video on the preferred Trend package in the past. Off the top of my head, I don't remember if it had the garage door opener. I feel like it may have. But I can't promise it will. So we'll have to just double check. We can double check the specs on the website again. So I'll get back to that question a little bit later. All right, I think we got to most of the questions. Favorite part of the interior was one that Connor asked. I think the overall comfort and size, like when I'm sitting up front here, I like the technology. I've got the smart cruise, I've got the easy to reach screen, wireless Android Auto. That's really my favorite part there. I will say one of my favorite parts of the exterior is these roof rails. They used to just put a cap on the front and back of these roof rails. I'm a kayaker, I like to have a really wide spread between my roof rails. And you can see this is all one piece. So it does come with the roof rails. You can spread them really wide and you can take extra cargo up there. However, you may not need to take a whole lot of cargo up there because you have a really good class-leading trunk right here. They put a little sticker on these new cars saying where the tailgate holder is because we used to put it sort of underneath there where we now have the camera. So they've just got a sticker that we can peel off. One thing that's going to be really hard to demonstrate on video is the floor seems to me to be very low compared to some of our other cars. And you're not sacrificing ground clearance or anything, so they've just reconfigured the shape of this car to give you a much, much larger trunk than you used to have. And when I say class leading, it really is class leading. We have a few people here that have seen the older versions of these cars and they're like, wow, that is definitely bigger than it used to be. So let's throw my teddy bear in here because this is how we measure trunk spaces here on the Kia Hyundai channel. Every one of our videos where we talk about trunk space, or just about everyone, we throw in my little teddy bear here. If you're looking at my own personal Kia Soul, if you were to buy something like that, or Hyundai Kona, same idea, teddy bear kind of fits, there's the end of the floor in the Kona. So you can see you're gaining a lot of space here. And you also have tremendous amount of height, and it's very square. So it's not like it's cut in or it's tilted in. You've got a really big, big opening here for the trunk. So really, really good. Sorry, another question. Is there a size difference from 21 to 22 Tucson? Absolutely. So if we take a look here, the Tucson for this 2022 model year is much, much larger. And really most of that space, you're gonna notice a comfortable driving environment, but most of that space is in the rear seat space, which we're gonna jump in the rear seat in a second, and in trunk space. So you do have a little bit longer vehicle, but it really does make for a better interior space in there. Just got a text from the Hyundai dealer. They need this car back right away. So we're gonna go to the rear seat, and then we'll make sure we wrap up the video. But before we do that, we're going to take your questions. So let me jump in the rear seat. You guys ask your questions now. I promise you we'll answer your questions. And then I just got a text coming through right now saying they need this vehicle back, and that's what we're going to do for them. So let's jump in the rear seat. Rear seat is a class different than the previous Tucson. A lot of people compare this to the Santa Fe of the previous generation, and that's probably a very fair comparison. It is a much bigger car than it used to be. So when we look at this preferred package, you do have vents in the back here. You do have pockets on both driver and passenger side, but the big thing you're gonna get is plenty of space. So when I jump in here, good headroom. Now I'm a little bit uncomfortable, so I'm gonna tilt this back, and we can go way, way, way back, like almost laying down, or we can put it in a nice comfortable spot for me. Tons of headroom here, and you've also got really, really good leg room. So you've got, like, there's the knee room there. I'm a 6 footer sitting behind a 6 footer, but you also have your legs flat on the seat. So rear leg room, if it's not class leading, it's gotta be really close. It is big back here. And I don't see any need to buy a larger SUV. I've sat in larger SUVs and they don't seem to have any more space than this one does. You also have a really nice armrest that props properly off the seat. So it sits where your elbow falls. You've got cup holders where you need them. And that works perfectly well for me because it just makes it more comfortable. All right, so we're gonna take your questions now, and then we are gonna wrap this one up because they're looking for this vehicle just up the road at our other Hyundai dealer. We're filming here, of course, in the Brantford Kia studio. So let's show you the car one more time, and we'll take your questions, and then we will make sure we wrap this one up. What have we got? Da-da-da-da. Okay, when was the backup cameras mandatory for all new cars? Backup cameras mandatory, I believe, in Canada for 2020 model year. I could be wrong about that, but I think that's when it was. Maybe 2019, 2020 for sure, I think. No question, size difference, there we go. I think that's all we got. Does the trunk have a powered option on higher trims? Absolutely. So the powered trunk option, not only is the trunk power opening on those cars, but you also have that smart key. So when you hold the smart key on your body and approach the back of the vehicle, just standing there, if you have it set up, you can just stand there. It senses the key is within proximity of the trunk, and the trunk will automatically open without you having to touch anything on the higher trims. On this trim, it is a manual trunk opening. So great question there. Gear shifter is a stick. I saw another trim with buttons. Yes, this one is a stick. Higher trims do have the buttons. And I think both are nice, but yes, this is a traditional gear shift there. Is there charging ports in the back seat? Great question. I didn't see any. Let's just double check again. No, not on this trim line. So there is a little space where you could probably put them in, and they probably have them in higher trims, but they're that. Can I lower the trunk floor? Good question as well. Not really. You do have a spare tire underneath here. So you have some space around there. Actually, you know what? I was wrong. You can lower it a couple inches at best. So a couple inches there, you can see the two tracks. It's sitting on the top track. You can lower it to the lower track right there. And so a little tiny bit of space in there to put trunk space. I didn't point out the extra 12 volt port back here. And of course you can fold down the seats by reaching for that handle, which is quite nice because those seats, again, in the larger trunk are a lot further away. There's no lever to pull that off the seats. You can reach it a lot easier right there. So some great questions there. And I did want to show you lighting. Why don't we show you that really quickly? One of the best things about some of these new cars is not just the lighting that you see right here, which is the daytime running lighting, but these are LED headlights. Anytime you get a car with LED headlights, you're going to really appreciate that white color. Now, for whatever reason, when I film it here, it looks much more yellow than white on the camera. It's very white in real life, and it's much closer to a daylight color. When you have that daylight color, you can really identify things at night. So not only is it bright, but it helps you identify things a little bit easier that way. So nice features there. And that's why I say, so between the LED lighting, wireless Android Auto, Apple CarPlay, smart cruise control, lane keep assist, BlueLink system, maybe the problem with this car is that it is high-end, and I just don't view it as high-end, but it's a pretty good value for what you're getting. And there's no real direct competitor in the Kia lineup right now. Sportage is a little bit different in size and has a few different options, including some features you can't get in the Sportage in this. And of course, the new Sportage is coming out. And if you're looking at that, a lot of it's gonna be similar. You're gonna have different styling, but you're gonna have similar sizing, similar option packages in that car as well. So really kind of an interesting car to me. Definitely suits me. It's the kind of car that I would buy. And you know, good value. If you don't need all the luxuries, this is kind of just the luxuries you need and not the luxuries you don't. All right, guys, we're only 29 minutes in, but we are going to cut this a little shorter. So do me a favor, hit that like button one last time. We'll have these cars again in the future. Tomorrow, we're going to have two Telluride's, different trims, in the same showroom, and these are both 2022 models coming up. Kevin looks like he's going to be mostly done by then. We'll find out. So we'll see what's going on. And so tune in tomorrow at 2 o'clock for those Telluride reviews. And I want to thank everyone for watching. If I missed something in this video, if you have a question, feel free to ask below in the comments. If you're not live with us, ask us in the comments. I will answer those questions, and I have no issues pulling this vehicle back in on a future day and going through even more questions. So I want to thank everyone for watching. It's been fun. I got to go return this vehicle, and we'll talk to you again tomorrow.